Panorama TV presents How'd They Do That, where we explore the world of professional photographers and share their techniques with you. Here's your host, Mark Wallace.
Hey everybody, welcome to this week's episode of How'd They Do That. I'm Mark Wallace. Well, this week on the show we have Jason McKee and Tomas Guzman from Spokane, Washington. Jason and Tomas both work at North by Northwest in Spokane, and Jason is a visual effects person and Tomas is a director of photography, but they joined forces about a year ago to create their first short film. It's called Lady Luck Case Number 37. The style is film noir, and it's about a 12-minute short film. Jason directed the film, and Tomas was the director of photography, and they're joining us today to talk about all the stuff it took to make this short film. So welcome to the show, guys.
Thank you. It's great being here.
Thanks a lot, guys.
Awesome. Well, let's dive right in. So, Jason, can you tell us a little bit, just give us an overview of the film, what it's about, and, you know, don't give away any of the fun at the end, but just for those people that haven't seen it, just tell us what this film is all about.
Well, yeah, it's a film noir that we really wanted to kind of pay homage to the old style film noir, not so much the, the new Sin City style, but the ones of, you know, like The Big Sleep and films like that, Maltese Falcon. It's about a detective that really is kind of thrown in the middle of a situation that he knows nothing about. And, it's just kind of, you just kind of dive right in the middle of it.
Laura Eisner disappeared with her parents' $270,000. She's been missing almost 6 weeks. I started looking 2 days ago, and these aren't the cases I'm used to. Big ones. So 6 weeks is a long head start on me. And I won't find her. Not without some luck.
Refill on your coffee?
You know, I really enjoyed watching this film because it's exactly as you said, you sort of just sort of dive in going, what is going on here? And then at the end, there is sort of that, it's really a nice ending. I like that. So I don't want to spoil it for people, but a terrific short film. So thanks for talking to us about this today. Well, first I want to ask where the script came from. So can you tell us a little bit about who wrote this, the short film?
Actually, the person who wrote the script was Tom Olson, and he also plays the lead actor in it, which his only character name was Our Man. Because no one is really called by their character name. So yeah, Tom Olson wrote the script. I read it on right before Christmas a few years back, and within 2 months we were shooting it.
You know, I really want to know how you formed the team. So you guys obviously knew each other from North by Northwest. So how did you get all the actors and the team that you needed to create this film? Can you talk a little bit more about that?
I was approached by Gretchen Oyster, who works on set as an assistant director, and she was looking for a director to direct the film, and so I came on, and then we just kept asking people we'd worked with on films, industry professionals, and it kind of went from there. That was the crew. Everyone just kind of jumped on board. They seemed excited by it. So
one of the things I really liked about this film was the use of the dolly, and you did a lot of great dolly moves. So can you tell me about who blocked all these camera moves? Was that Tomas or Jason? Did you have some ideas about that? Tell us a little bit about how you planned how the camera was going to move in that environment.
Well, I was very clear from the get-go that this had to be absolutely, bump-free on the camera. There couldn't be any, shaky camera or anything, and I went through and I had a pretty good plan of what I wanted to see, how I wanted to see shots lead into other shots, and it turned out that all of those shots pretty much had to be on a dolly because I wanted a constantly moving camera, but without any bumps, and actually what I was looking for wouldn't have even worked with a Steadicam.
Well, let's talk a little bit about the equipment that you used. So, Tomas, can you talk to us about the cameras, the dollies? Did you lay track? Just walk us through what you were using for the entire film.
Well, we shot Lady Luck on a Sony F900R. It's an HD cam camera capable of shooting 1080p. And the lens I used, actually, I'm gonna hold it up right now, was this guy. I used one lens for the entirety of this film. It is a Fujinon super wide CineZoom lens. And I decided to go with this lens because A, it's super wide. It's a 4.5 millimeter to a 59 millimeter, and it's excruciatingly fast. It's a 1.9 aperture. So that meant that I could get a lot of fall off, and I could just get a lot of incredible depth on our shots. So that was my weapon of choice going into this film, and I'm the type of guy that I don't want to really muck around with a lot of different stuff. I just want to pick a tool and use it to the best of my abilities. So that's the camera and the lens we used.
So on that lens, actually, that's a zoom lens. Usually when you're shooting at 1.9 or something like that, you really want to have that that depth of field locked in. So did you zoom in and out on any of the shots, or did you lock it to a specific focal length and then dolly everything? How did you handle that?
That's a pretty good question. I try to just experiment and do things in a lot of different ways. And a matter of fact, in a couple shots of Lady Luck, we had to shoot them several times because I was doing zooms. And a lot of times I was doing them manually. There was just a nice little tension feel that I wanted to get. There's a specific scene down in the basement where we're pulling out from our man. And I literally, as we are dollying the camera back on tracks, I am zooming out at the exact same time. It just felt right. The look on the monitor, it just looked good. We were looking at that saying, this is what we want to do. So there was a combination of locking the shot off, allowing the dolly to make the move, and then there was that one specialty shot where I said, hey, let's zoom this sucker out and then dolly back at the same time. Is that insane? Yeah, but we got it.
Yeah, and I know it was really tough to try to match it and not have, you know, there was absolutely zero room for error, you know, and you're dollying the, you're moving the camera back and trying to zoom out, yeah. And trying to hold focus.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, it's quite a challenge.
Well, one of the things that's also really apparent in this film, you really sculpted the light in an amazing way. There are just these pockets of light. And in fact, there's one scene that I really like. It's at the very beginning when our protagonist is at a table. He can't get a smoke. And the waitress tells him there's no smoking. And then you have this camera move and you see the cook and he's puffing away on a cigarette. And just how that light is lighting that diner, you know, again, you've isolated just these little scenes within the greater scene. So what modifiers, what lighting equipment, and how did you plan how to do that? Because you did it so well.
Well, pretty much, I just stuck to a basic Fresnel tungsten kind of light setup. It was all about hard shadows. Most of our stuff was all at night, so, you know, I didn't have to worry about using any HMIs or anything like that. And it was really finding any tool that I could to shape the light, whether it was flags, scrims, it was squeezers, so dimmers on a lot of things. And that diner was just rich with nice little light. We already had great little lamps on each table. We had some nice overheads. And what I would have to do is I'd have to go up sometimes and just knock out some of the overhead so I could just get one pool here, one pool there, one pool there. And then we had to make sure that we were highlighting our talent who were in the booth. And that also became problematic because that whole dolly move, you know, we're exposing that entire world. And I had to find, through trial and error, where can I hide lights? A lot of little dado lights. They're about this small. They got little dimmers on them. I can stick them in a tight corner in a booth, dim them where I need to, make sure I'm getting some nice rims on my talent, or I got enough fill, you know, my ratios are looking good on my talent. It's just going through that trial and error process, doing it, watching it, fixing it. I mean, that's it. And until we get what we're looking for.
Yeah, and we actually started with quite a few lights in the setup, and then through the, you know, we'd do the move, and then we'd do a few takes, and we'd realize in those takes we were seeing light A or light B, and then we'd have to pare it down and figure out how to relight it to essentially do the same thing, and that was quite a challenge.
So when you set up your lighting, did you meter the light, or were you just strictly looking at your monitors to understand, you know, the light ratios and where the light was falling and how it was falling?
What's really nice about the Sony HD cam, the F900R, it's got a color HD viewfinder. So when you're shooting video, I usually don't use light meters when I'm using video because I can set a nice zebra bar range in the camera. And usually I set that to about 98 to 102 in terms of IRE. And then what I can do is I look in my viewfinder and I find out where those hot spots are at. Because, you know, there's times that I do want hot spots. You know, you need highlights in your shot, and then you also have to have those deep shadows. So I basically just look through my viewfinder, find out where my highlights were at, and then kind of twist my lights or tweak my lights appropriately to make sure I had really good ratios.
Awesome. Well, Jason, I did notice in the film that there were some things that were anachronistic, specifically, you know, the zip ties to hold down our hero. There were some late model cars. There are cell phones in the film. So, you know, and to me, I thought this was set in the 40s because of the music. And is this on purpose, or is that because of some budget considerations that you sort of had the mixing of different eras?
No, it was definitely done on purpose, but it was done on purpose because we had to. We were doing this for literally no money. So we knew that we couldn't get period cars. So we just thought we would, you know, run with it. So we purposely threw in all era, you know, any era we could, relatively modern, you know, from 40s clothing style or 50s. And, you know, we had cars from the 70s. And then we also had modern cars. And then we purposely threw in the cell phone in there, where normally I would have had him go to maybe a phone that's on a table or, you know, maybe on a wall when he talks at the end. But we wanted to really, in somewhat of a subtle way, tell people that we know what we're doing. This is intentional. It's not like we accidentally put these cars in, you know. So we definitely did all of that on purpose, having the cell phone, having the different era cars, and then, you know, keeping the clothing style, that older style.
Well, let's talk about the editing. Did you edit this, Jason or Tomas? Who edited, and what suite of tools did you use to edit this film?
I edited the film on, it was originally going to be Avid, and that was just because I was, you know, we were using the tools here at North by Northwest, and we were primarily an Avid company, or using Avid at that point. And then we were in the transition of going into Final Cut Pro, and I just found it was kind of a convoluted process that it didn't need to be, but I ended up using, you know, getting a rough cut done in Avid, and then exporting an EDL, and then doing the final tweaks, and then finishing it just right out of Final Cut Pro.
And a lot of the effects that you used, you know, you've got these film overlays and some grain and some softening and just some really nice effects to this. Even there's like the little blip that comes up when you have to change reels. I noticed that. Just really well done. So did you use any plugins for that, or is it all stock effects and Final Cut?
Essentially, I finished the film in After Effects. And I applied the look, which was, you know, essentially taking and duplicating the layer and then throwing it out of focus and then bringing down the opacity to make kind of a romantic filter to it. And then on top of that, adding a lot of grain to give that kind of, you know, maybe stylized old film, black and white film noir look.
Well, I thought you guys did a phenomenal job again. Well, we're out of time today, so thank you so much, Jason and Tomas, for joining us today.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much, guys.
You bet. Well, thanks you guys for joining us here on How They Do That. Remember, if you have somebody that you'd like to see on the show, you can send your suggestion to me at askmark@adorama.com, and we just might have them here on How They Do That. Thanks for joining me. I'll see you again next week.
This episode is brought to you by Adorama TV. Visit the Adorama Learning Center, where you'll find photography tips and techniques, links to the gear used in this episode, and related videos. For all the latest photography, video, and computer gear, visit Adorama.com. And the next time you're in New York City, visit our store, located on 18th Street between 5th and 6th Avenue.